Hello, and thank you for joining us. Welcome from me, Michael Scott, in Oxford in the UK, and from my joint convener, Sanford J. Ungar, in Washington, DC, to the 13th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University, and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative, in association with the Las Casas Institute for Human Dignity at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford, and with Campion Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand you over to Sandy, who is director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished panel and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session. From the start, you can type in questions to the panel by using the button at the bottom of your screen. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try and put them to the panel to consider later on. We urge you to ask questions and try to do so right from the start so that we don't get a bottleneck at the end of the first part of the session. I will try and put as many of the questions as possible to the panel. So I hope you enjoy today's event. And with that, over to you, Sandy.
Thank you, Mike. Pleasure to work with you again, as we do monthly on these international dialogues, overall called Free Speech at the Crossroads. Today, our topic is truth and the rise of popular lies. And it's a very current subject for all of us, I think, in what we do and what we observe around us. I want to introduce our very distinguished panel, Baroness Jenny Randerson, who represents the Liberal Democratic Party in the House of Lords in the British Parliament, Stephen Hess from the Brookings Institution, who has a long memory of some of these events in the United States. He was a White House aide or advisor in the Eisenhower, Nixon, Ford, and Carter administrations. Erica Green, a Washington correspondent covering education for the New York Times, formerly from the Baltimore Sun, and right in the middle of the firing line of some of the hot political issues that are either entertaining or plaguing or worrying the United States at the moment. And of course, John Battle, former Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, Foreign and Commonwealth Affairs for the Labour Party government, and now in Leeds, in Northern England, coming to us today from Leeds. Jenny Randerson, I believe, from Westminster, from London today. Erica from New York, as it happens, and Stephen Hess from here in Washington with me. I'd like to start out by just a slight trip down memory lane to ask, I think a lot of us believe that this is a brand new phenomenon, the tendency of political leaders to use falsehoods to advance their own agendas and to substitute often popular, easy to understand, it seems, lies for the truth. Steve, you may have some historical perspective on this. Please remember to unmute yourself, Steve.
Okay, you can hear me now, Sandy?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay, yeah, I thought you would ask me something about that. So I've been worrying about, was there any event of President Eisenhower when I was at the White House that somehow illustrated this point? And I came up with this one. You remember the U-2? U-2 was the plane. It was almost like a high-powered glider. Had a pilot and a camera, and it flew over the Soviet Union taking pictures. It was a super secret operation. On May 1st, May Day, 1960, it was shot down over the Soviet Union, and the pilot lived and was recovered. What was particularly difficult to the president was that he was in Paris. He was about to start a very important meeting with Nikita Khrushchev. What was going to be the response to this? The director of the Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA, proposed to him that he, he proposed that he would resign, take the blame, say Eisenhower had nothing to do with it, and had knowledge that this was would probably be acceptable to Khrushchev, and the apology, and that the conference could continue. What was Eisenhower to do? Eisenhower said he would not do that. It would be unconscionable for the President of the United States to admit that he was not aware of his country's national security apparatus. And he told the truth, and he had been very deeply involved in this. And the conference failed. In fact, he returned, he flew home, and I can remember as the staff, as we went to the airport to wish him a fair return, to wave and say we were so proud of him. And that was an example that I could think of where the reason where he told the truth was to protect what he thought was the national security apparatus.
So these days, it seems that certainly our most recent previous president, Donald Trump, would utter falsehoods in order to protect the presidency. He would do just the opposite, although some people believe that he couldn't necessarily tell the truth from a falsehood because he was so eager to promote his own agenda. I wonder, I might ask Jenny or John if they have seen anything like this happen in other places recently in Western democratic countries, perhaps including the one where you live and serve. Jenny.
Well, certainly it is accepted now, I think, among those who watch politics in the UK, that we have a prime minister who has a laxer approach to the truth than has been the case in the past. I think that the difference I would draw is that, of course, people have failed to tell the whole truth and told downright lies in the past. Most of the obvious examples have been ones which involve national security. And the most famous one that we have, I think, in the UK in recent years was the famous Dodi dossier that was supposedly sexed up at the time of the Iraq War, beginning of the Iraq War, 2003, alleging there were nuclear weapons. Now, that's all associated with security. And that is when I think we have come across obvious situations where there's a gap between the truth and what we've been told. But what we have now is something that goes way beyond the occasional lapse, way beyond what we used to call Labour spin under Tony Blair. And now have a situation where when we're told things, we really have no idea as to whether they're true or not, because breaking promises and failing to tell the whole truth has become a modus operandi, basically. And that's
Erica,
not
I'm sorry, please. At all. Erica, you're working day to day as a correspondent in Washington and in the field of education, having to deal with this question of whether you're being told the truth, whether now or before the change of administrations, and also what mainstream media will do about labeling things as true or false. That's been a major dramatic change in American journalism. Please remember to unmute yourself.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the last 4 years, you know, was every single day, it was, we were sitting in our offices trying to sift out what was true and false and really trying to figure out how we present, you know, what we knew were complete and utter, you know, lies. And the Times, you know, this is an internal debate. Externally, our editor has addressed the use of lie versus falsehood versus misleading. And there were really strong feelings within the newsroom and especially outside of it about whether or not we should, you know, do our duty to tell people that, you know, what they were hearing, what we were telling them was not true, and how to forcefully do so. And of course, there were many who thought we should use outright, you know, lies. And our, you know, the Times felt that, you know, you don't use the word lie unless you can basically prove intent. But after it happened every day for, you know, I guess we were in year two, we kind of were like, how many more of these do we need before we just, you know, call a spade a spade. So it was really, really tough. You know, for me, covering education, I didn't actually run into that too much with Betsy DeVos, which is the cabinet secretary that I covered. But now we are in this, you know, huge debate over what children are being taught in school. It's been branded critical race theory. And the very premise of this debate is a falsehood. And it's been really difficult to figure out how to cover it. In a way that we're not given any credence to something that is a false premise, but also, you know, tackle what is the, you know, the foundation of the news. And, you know, the way that I have done it is I decided that I wasn't going to play into the branding and the false equivalencies that are being presented right now. And I'm going to cover, you know, what is behind this talking point. And so I have gone about it where, in a way that I don't even, if I can help it, I don't even mention the words critical race theory, because that's not what we are talking about. What we're talking about is racism. We're talking about slavery, you know, the hard words that no one wants to acknowledge. So they come up with these really misleading ways of describing what's really at issue. And so it's really tough. It's ongoing. It's going to be, you know, we just saw it really take hold in Virginia. It's going to have consequences politically. It's having consequences within schools. And I think it's only going to get more tricky and more tumultuous to explain this over the next year.
Just to clarify for a second, what you mean about Virginia is that parents have been led to believe that their children are being taught so-called critical race theory when in fact they are not.
Correct.
That's what you're alluding to.
Yes, thank you.
John Battle, if you'll mute yourself, unmute yourself. Thank you. In your experience in government, in Labor Party government, did you have to grapple with issues of how closely the truth was shaved or cast aside?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, as someone that was partially involved in it, I think I voted against every time we went to war. And what happened is truth and perception are linked words, really. Because I remember that, in a sense, what moved in on the discussion were focus groups, opinion polls, and a view that a politician ought to respond to the people rather than lead. And I think that is part of the challenge. There was an American commentator, I think in the 1990s, PJ O'Rourke, who said that politics was becoming a case of every politician had to sustain an image of competence from one day to the next. And when I was a government minister, I actually thought that was long-term thinking, because I was trying to survive from one news bulletin to the next, you know, got up and listened to the morning news bulletin, hope I got down to the 1 o'clock and then down to the 6 o'clock news. And if I wasn't grilled to death on Newsnight, I'd had a good day. But what happened was, I think things have changed. Certainly, it's not the image of competence anymore. I think politicians are now encouraged to be dramatic personalities, or pragmatists, if you like. Distraction politics is a key kind of theme. So performance has become more important than actual competence. And again, it was the image, not the reality of competence. So I think that notion of survival started to get buried into the political system. So politicians are about their own survival. That has made them more tribal and less able to face the challenges of service to others. And perhaps in terms of our system, where you're geographically located, you have to provide some community championship, some community leadership, as well as responding in London to make sure that the laws and budgets fit their needs. And I think what's getting rubbed out is that leadership, the leadership that challenges, puts a case, argues and persuades with reason, rather than just going back into the tribal huddle, if you like, of groupthink, which really operates as a kind of permanent campaigning mode. And I think that's part of the problem, that we're in permanent campaigning mode. Yet when you get to Parliament, a lot of the time, laws and budgets are made in the background in committees, as Jenny knows, where people get round the table and generally discuss quite reasonably about trying to sort things out in terms of making decent laws and budgets.
Steve, you worked for four different presidents, three of them Republicans, one of them a Democrat, Jimmy Carter, who made a major thing of saying he will not lie, he never lies, as if he had to reassure people about that, and perhaps in contrast to others.
Yeah, his mother, Miss Lillian, had some thoughts about that. His mother is quite an amazing woman, who, almost 70 years old, a nurse. She went off to the Peace Corps to India and dealt with people who had plague and so forth. And they asked her, "But your son says he never lies." And she said, some little white lies, maybe. And the reporter says, well, what is a little white lie? And she said, well, remember when you came in the room, I said you were wearing a beautiful dress. But it does illustrate something. We all lie. It's the lying and the unlying for very, very different reasons. Of course, was brought on charges for lying for a sexual matter. We can understand that. And then, as you point out, Trump. Trump makes no distinction between lying and unlying. For him, there were so many lies that the Washington Post had a reporter assigned to track it every day, and they used a Pinocchio symbol. How many lies did he did today? In his case, I think it was truly pathological. So people lie for different reasons. And of course, the presidency has a long history of lying, of telling the truth. We started myth of George Washington. Remember George Washington? He said at age six, I cannot tell a lie. I chopped down the cherry tree. Of course, he didn't say that. It was in the first biography of him. And why? The reporter said it would tell, author said, hey, it would help sell books. So it's an interesting subject. And it goes well beyond the specific question.
John, you wanted to make a point.
Do you think, Stephen, that sometimes, though, I think the most difficult part of politics is, in a sense, that we make too much of a binary between truth and lies and make it too strong. And in a way, it's the half lie that does the damage a lot of the time, or holding back some of the truth, so that we're in a murky, murky world. And someone said, because truth and lies is so complicated, democracy isn't possible anymore because it's chaos. And I just wonder whether that notion of the half-life. I mean, I'll give an example. For some time, I worked in a psychiatric hospital, and I remember one of the opposition on the benches stood up and said, and John Battle's come out of a psychiatric hospital. And I tried to explain that I was on the staff and not a patient, but it didn't really wash in the media. But the half-life was out and around the houses. So I think sometimes it's the half-story that causes the problem when we're trying to convey complex information about politics, laws, and budgets, that we're not doing very well in finding the language to describe the complex, nuanced realities that we live in. And it includes, I'm always delighted to hear your first story. The historical imagination is sadly lacking as well in the instant present world, because we're in a very short time survival frame. Everything's short term. And a historical dimension is sadly too often missing, and that doesn't help sort out where we are in reality.
Well, and in some countries that purport to be a part of the West, like Poland, it is now a crime to utter your accurate historical recollection of some things that went on in Poland during World War II. You can go to prison for your historical memory. Jenny, do you have any examples of your own that?
Well, I was going to respond to John's point. The rise of social media means that actually the lies live on. Though in some ways political discourse has gone faster and faster, in other ways the lies live on. And we used to say, oh, well, it's tomorrow's chip paper. This is a very British thing. We used to eat fish and chip out of newspaper, which was apparently very clean. We used to say, in other words, it's only in the newspapers, it's in the bin tomorrow, okay? But the point is that the lies live on. And once it's been told, or mistold, or exaggerated, or half told, it is there on social media and can come up again and again and again. And I think that that's what has happened with the advent of social media. Obviously, it's had huge implications, but it has amplified the voice of what we in Britain call the tabloid press. And we are blessed with the tabloid press. We are cursed with a press that at the worst end is almost a cartoon approach to politics, only interested in drama and trouble, not interested in the day-to-day stuff. And then, of course, that then has a knock-on impact, because the more serious end of the press is obviously responding to that the whole time. And it even infiltrates into the BBC, which is rather cowed at the moment in the UK because it's accused of not being unbiased. And therefore, the BBC is repeating what's in social media, repeating what's on Twitter today. And that therefore becomes a large echo chamber.
Erica, do you run into that problem of people becoming accustomed to what they've seen on social media and then expecting you to confirm it?
I mean, we particularly ran into that problem when the most famous tweeter of all time was allowed to use social media. It was really difficult to combat anything that Donald Trump said on Twitter. I was sitting here thinking of all of the ways that you sometimes felt at a loss. I mean, there are people who still believe that Barack Obama was not born in this country. There are still to this day, right? There are still, and let's use a more recent example, there are still people who believe that the election was rigged. It feels like there's just, nothing that we can do to really overcome overcome that, and the damage is so lasting. And on social media in particular, you know, when you think about even the coverage of the January 6th insurrection, you know, a lot of what was put out by Republican lawmakers, you know, still lives on. And, you know, that there were peaceful protesters, you know, that narrative is incredibly difficult to course correct once it's gone on. And I would say more Twitter than even Facebook and others. And, you know, I will say also the reaction to stories really pushes the media a bit, especially when you've put out a story that is combating a narrative that you know, popular politicians have created. You just get completely bombarded with alternative facts, really nasty backlash. I mean, I'm in New York today because the New York Times' 1619 project will be released as a book tomorrow. And my colleague, Nicole Hannah-Jones, is, you know, is preparing for that. And, you know, I put a copy of the book on social media today, and people right now are tweeting at me saying that what was in that project, which was truly just an examination of the legacy of slavery, is fiction. I don't really know what to do with that. I mean, the word fiction has been used dozens of times just this morning in response to just a picture of the book. And that, you know, that comes directly from Donald Trump's, you know, war on the 1619 Project, his, you know, his rallying cry for patriotic education. We're at a point now that over the course of a year, and obviously this has been championed by other conservative politicians, which is kind of how we got this critical race theory, I'll call it an issue in the first place. But we're now at the point where a year later, you know, after Donald Trump first attacked this on social media, that people are now calling slavery fiction. It's really tough. So social media, you know, that's all to say. Social media plays a huge part in where we are.
John Bettel, do the media find themselves in a similar situation in the UK where it seems sometimes forced to or pressured to take a side that they know is not true?
I think I remember going into the television studios and seeing the what they used to call the day board, where they write up the items of importance to report on, and they would take it from one or two newspapers, really, the same agenda. Now the social media will also help run that agenda. And I think that encloses the agenda around a very, very tight, limited frame within the what I'd call the tribal silo system that just repeats half-truths all the time, if not downright lies, as Eric is suggesting. I think at the end, I tend to think that we've got to get back to, in my neighbourhood where I live in inner city Leeds, hardly anybody reads the newspapers, hardly anybody watches the news. Some are on social media, mainly to communicate with their own families very locally. So there's not a great interest in the great issues of politics. And I think that's where the populism issue is really much more about disaffection and disconnection than any great revolutionary overturning of the elite establishment. But what you find is if you talk to people face to face, you get a different story entirely. And I think, to give a practical example, one of the worst expressions that I ever hear is that, you know, when you're having a discussion with someone and they turn around and say to you, "I hear what you say," and you know that they mean exactly the opposite. They mean, "I completely disagree with you. I'm never going to listen to you or communicate with you." And in Yorkshire, the word tolerance can be a bit curmudgeonly. It can mean, well, I've lived next to them for a long time, but I don't really like them, and I hope they'll move away before I do. Tolerance isn't a great virtue. So how do we get to respect And I think the language of politics, the language of the street, should be about changing from tolerance to respect, where we actually start to learn not just to hear, but to listen to each other properly. And I think that's what's being rubbed out by social media. It's the inability to listen to each other and then exchange and share.
I think it's a very good thing, and we should pursue at some length the question of the social media, because we're opening up the world to a people who are not experts and will have a lot of misinformation, but deserve to be heard, but also deserve to be corrected. But there's something else going on as well. When I got into politics, helping a friend run for Congress in 1956, how did we do it? Well, we gathered our friends and our friends' friends and so forth. And it wasn't that removed, actually, when somebody like an Eisenhower got into politics in 1952. And of course, what's happened since? We have an industry of consultants, an industry who produce films, give advice to candidates, and produce a lot of things that think that they will get elected at a once removed from that. I mean, George Bush, the second one, an honorable man, hired a guy named Lee Atwater and ran a vicious campaign. And it was all, when it was all over, he said, oh, well, that was just a campaign. Now I'm president and we'll run it entirely differently. But it wasn't entirely differently. All of the slush that comes out of the campaign gets moved into the politics now. And it's a different world.
And Jenny.
I'm thinking of my taxi journey this morning. In the course of a quarter of an hour, my taxi driver told me that the world, every important country in the world, was run by a paedophile ring, and no one had ever isolated the COVID virus, and it was all a scam. So I asked him why he thought those things, and he told me it was on the internet. It was all over the internet. So what he was doing was looking at, in his echo chamber, at views that appeared similar to his own. And I was thinking, as we had this discussion, the contrast, you know, I live in South Wales, and the contrast with the situation maybe 50, 100 years ago. There are a lot of mines in South Wales, or there were, and it was a poor part of the world, but it was one with a strong impetus to what's called self-improvement. And the way in which the miners gained their self-improvement was by going to the miners' institutes, which were community centres, we call them nowadays, where they read the newspapers. And the difference between social media and reading the newspaper is that when you open the newspaper, you find yourself reading lots of stories about things you knew nothing about before you open that newspaper. So you end up knowing about new things. And the problem with social media is that it narrows us down. It intensifies our views. And we don't hear from people with
diffuse. Erica, is that a problem you confront?
Yeah, it is. You know, social media has its value. I mean, as a reporter, it keeps me plugged into the pulse of the country, or a very small sliver of the country. I peruse it to see what people are talking about and how they're feeling about certain things. And obviously it's a really great way to also monitor a lot of disinformation. But I do think that the social media, you know, functions largely as an echo chamber. And that's true for journalists too. You know, we all follow each other. We all follow DC, New York, you know, or another big city, we tend to exist in this tunnel as well. And so I make it a point to really branch out and follow, you know, folks of all political parties, persuasions. But at the end of the day, I think, you know, social media is there to kind of create an echo chamber. So it's a, you know, it makes it even more important and more essential that reporters try to branch out as much as possible, because they're, you know, if the 2016 election was any indication of the consequences of an echo chamber, you know, we got it there. You know, I think it has a role. It connects a lot of people from across the country. But you know, it's always the danger of it is always that it's just so not representative of the United States. So we tend to get trapped in a mindset that it is, and that's when you see really poor coverage, I think.
Right. And of course, in concept, I think a lot of people admire social media as being very democratic with a small d, that any voice can be heard. And speaking, I mean, if there's one thing that we can now see that Trump and his ilk and other places have counted upon, is a great many people felt and perhaps still feel excluded from the political dialogue. Yeah. That there's this establishment, and of course the term was coined in the UK, I believe, that works everything out, and then other people have to sort of decide how they're going to adapt to it. Model, if you can call it that, has broken down completely. Mm-hmm. John?
I think it feeds, politics also likes social media, because social media drives towards conflict, and it likes to stir up the drama, just as I think Jenny was saying earlier about the media in general. And because of the conflict, it drives the politics of fear. And it's always much easier to have an intense politics of fear, demonize your opponent, go for ad hominem arguments and get the person rather than the policy. And that generates that permanent campaigning style that's incredibly negative. And I think that makes it very difficult to introduce any longer term vision of where we're going, or have a political conversation that actually opens up complex questions that might not have immediate answers that we have to address. And that was reflected, I think, in the COP26 conversations we've just had in Glasgow, that we couldn't get out of the short term. There was a wonderful moment when the Queen urged all the participants to rise above the politics of the moment. Sadly, the BBC reported that she'd urged all delegates to put politics aside. She didn't actually say that. She said, can we get out of short-term politics and try to get to longer-term vision? And I think that's the challenge of both the media and of politics together.
Don't we also have to worry about getting, am I on? Misinformation, lies out of the system. I don't think we do a very good job of that. And we have to give more thought to that. In other words, we had the same situation back in the 1920s when there was suddenly the burgeoning of radio, and the federal government passed a National Radio Act. And then it expanded to cover the television, and you apply for a license, and if you don't follow certain rules, you can lose your license. And so we have, after all, Rupert Murdoch wanted to become to have television stations, had to become an American citizen. Isn't that wonderful? You know, so we have rules now, and I don't think that in the corporate structure of public internet now, we have any of those rules, except what Facebook chooses to make rules for itself. Worry. Well,
Facebook is a private government in many respects now. Things that several people are saying, including Erica, remind me of my early days as a journalist and some tough times during the Nixon administration, when we thought perhaps the First Amendment might even be shut down in some fashion. What happened with a lot of people, I think journalists who felt over-scrutinized at that time, was that they tried to get everybody's version. I mean, I wrote a book about the FBI many years ago, and what I found myself doing was getting everybody's version of the same events, no two were the same, and trying to perform a kind of Solomonic role of piecing them together what was most plausible. And I think back on it, it was a very hazardous thing to try to do. I might have gotten it right, I might have gotten it wrong in some cases, but and we weren't contending with social media at the time, but we were contending with people who had an investment in different truths. And I think that's what John was getting at before to some extent, is, well, is it true enough? Is something true enough to follow? That's a pretty weak standard, if that's what we've come down to. Jenny.
There is, in the UK, we have, I've mentioned already that the BBC is under a fair amount of pressure at the moment. And they, one of the things the UK, the BBC has done for some years now, in an attempt to get a balance, is to always have someone from the other point of view. However much there is a consensus on one side of the story, they go for someone, they always present the other point of view, and they present it in a way which actually gives the impression that they're evenly balanced. I'll give you two examples. One is on the discussions about the in the run-up to the Brexit vote. Every time you had economists on one side saying the EU was really good for Britain's trade and so on, they wheeled out someone who opposed it, an economist. And there was an economist, all right? There were dozens on one side and an economist on the other. And they've done the same in the climate change debate, and I'm sure John will recognize this. You know, the consensus among scientists is very much that there are climate change is happening. But that for years, the BBC have wheeled out Nigel Lawson to argue with that point of view. Now, Nigel Lawson was a Chancellor of the Exchequer, a very prominent politician, but he is not a climate scientist. But he happens to be a climate change denier. So he turns up in all these debates as if it is a balanced debate. So trying to get that middle way, if I could put it that way, can itself be misleading.
You know, what you're referring to, Erica used the term before, false equivalency. The problem in the United States recently has been that lies, untruths, falsehoods, whatever word we're going to settle on, are often given the same platform as the widely accepted truths. And so, I mean, for climate change, all I have to do is look at the thermometer. I mean, and look at the glaciers melting, and look, it's not a question of, well, are they really melting or are they not melting? They're melting. So we don't need an alternative fact or an alternative view of that, nor of many of the things that are at play in the national politics now. Erica, do you think the Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, the sort of stalwarts of the mainstream media are doing well enough with the issue of false equivalencies?
Okay, I'll be careful here because I think we're all doing our best. I mean, I think there was a moment I would say for the first 2 years of the Trump administration, you know, the Main Street media in general, the mainstream press was really trying to manage this extraordinary president and this extraordinary time with by staying really focused on this notion of objectivity. And because it was just such an emotionally charged, politically charged time, we kind of clung to that to get through and to maintain trust. And in doing so, I will include myself, I think, you know, in trying to use, you know, objectivity as a great equalizer, we gave rise and prominence to false equivalencies. But frankly, I just think that was a function of not really having a choice, because we had to cover this administration. And you know, differing views do have a place. And I also think, you know, the election itself arguably turned out the way it did because we ignored a large swath of the country. So I think everyone was trying to really figure out how to not make the same mistakes, and that led to more mistakes. I do think, you know, halfway through, you know, everyone took a gut check and became a lot more aggressive about not giving, you know, equal weight to false equivalencies. I think what I noticed the change actually after, forgive me, I noticed the change, I would say, I think after the clearing of the protesters, when the president went to wield the Bible, my observation, and look, I didn't cover the White House, right? So I'm not here to judge. I don't know what I would have done as a White House reporter. I, you know, my colleagues are fantastic. I watch them in awe from afar, usually right across the
room.
The way. Yeah, I sat like right across from Peter Baker. And you know, it was really, really tough, but you know, I think it was just a learning exercise and how to cover a historic, extraordinary time that none of us had been through before.
And anticipated.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I see that questions are pouring in, and so I think it's time to go back to our colleague Mike Scott in Oxford to ask him to curate those questions and present them to the panelists. Mike, over to you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. What a great discussion we're having. I think Kevin Bishop has been asking a question which you've been talking to, and he was saying, what are your observations on the binary framing of ideas and situations? And I just wonder if I can add to that, do you consider that the use of bite-sized messages actually encourages the politicians in particular to fall into lying? I'd like to take that. Bite-sized conversations. John, battle?
Yeah, I think it does. I was noticing, I saw a person, we were looking at the, you know, there used to be a phrase, I've forgotten who it was, but I think it was the governor of New York who said, was it, we'll campaign in poetry and govern in prose. And then someone pointed out that all the phrases that Boris has introduced, like get Brexit done, build back better, all the phrases are kind of four syllables, classic poetry mantras that mean are practically meaningless but echo round and everyone has to bow down to. So I think the narrowing of the language is a real problem, and I think the sloganization of politics is a real problem. And but it also means that binary, I'll give an example, that binary then builds into the insistence on having a clash and a contest all the time over ideas in a binary way. I remember once I was invited on the television. It was actually Newsnight, and we were invited to go to a program. I was to go and a conservative was to go, and we decided to take a taxi from the House of Commons to share the fare, as it were, to get to the television studio at 10:30 at night, whenever it was. And on the way, I said to the conservative colleague of mine, I was the Labour, obviously, I said, what are your views on this then? Do you differ? Because I've not heard your views. And amazingly, he completely agreed with me. So when we got into the studio, the table was there. There was the chair for the interviewer and a table and a chair at either side. So I went and sat in the middle chair. So we were sat together, Conservative and Labour, with the interview facing us. And he blew his top and he said, where's the researcher? Are you going to disagree? If not, you're going home. And we couldn't do the debate because we didn't disagree. And I think it's that binary pressure that causes the problem. And I'm actually, I'm always minded, there was a phrase, was it was kind of parodied for it in a way, but Donald Rumsfeld came out you know, with that great phrase about the unknown unknowns, almost the Wittgenstein bit, really. There are some things we don't know. And I think we, as politicians, ought to be honest about things we don't know, that we're uncertain of. But try going on the radio and TV saying, well, I'm not sure about that. You know, the plug would be pulled pretty quickly. So I think the reduction of the language to slogans, short sound bites, yes, it has a play on an election poster, but it's not helpful for political discourse of complex matters. And I've always believed that the people I represent live complex enough lives, could juggle enough things to actually hold on to complex ideas and manage them. And I think it's a way of underestimating the people to boil things down to short, meaningless slogans.
Can I jump in there and agree wholeheartedly with John? If you look at old political leaflets from even 25, 30 years ago, and certainly from 50 years ago, you will find that they are very long-winded and the words are much longer than the ones we use now. And I believe that there is a general tendency for things to be very short and sharp. If you watch old films, you will see the scenes are much longer then than they are these days. Scenes are very cut and thrust. So we've throughout the Western world, certainly, we've gone for this simplification, boiling it down. We're always told in campaigning terms, you've got to put it in 3 points and they've got to be three short ones. And I believe it's a dangerous simplification. And in Britain, we have had a very dangerous simplification because the debate on Brexit was held in very simplistic terms. And it didn't go into technical details of the customs union and what it meant. And the result is that we now have a situation in Britain following Brexit where we have the results of a very fundamental change in our relationship with the rest of the world. And that those results include supply problems, shortages in shops and so on. And there are also issues in Northern Ireland as a result of this. And the point is that people are saying now, if only people had explained it to us. But it was held in very simple black and white terms. And now people are surprised and people worried. And I think we should have had a more in-depth debate. We might have come to the same conclusion, but people wouldn't have been surprised by what is now happening.
What I've learned from the Las Casas Institute, which is associated with the Dominican order and the Dominican tradition, I think I learned from them somewhere in their library. There was an old phrase from the great Thomas Aquinas who said that wisdom is translating the complex into the naturally clear and simple, but without reducing it to the naively simplistic. And yesterday we heard that Boris has cracked cars, coal, cash, and trees. So we've done COP and can move back onto Brexit.
Hi.
Yeah. Thanks for that. Angela Preston is asks, hello, Angela, nice to hear from you again. Can people be intimidated out of speaking the truth? Or are people intimidated out of speaking the truth? Stephen or Erica, do you want to?
I don't find that much of a problem. People on the internet seem to be, and social media seem to have no limit to what they want to say. You know, I did, but forgive me for moving back, because we ended the last with some comments on Erica on the state of the media, or at least the print media. And I just wanted to pick up on that in the United States. We do have a little problem because we're covering two countries at the same time. Our problems aren't exactly the same. I get, when I wake up in the morning, I open the door, I have our three major newspapers. I turn on the television, I get an aggregator that gives me what's left. And I feel I'm pretty well informed at that level. I think, in fact, the Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post do a very good job of what they do. The problem overall is how much is not done. If you look at the whole media of the United States, you see how undercovered our state capitals are, our state legislatures are, our governors and our mayors, where increasingly very important things are happening. Well, they can't afford to do it all, but there are great gaps in what person will learn when they turn to the media, and the gaps happen to be on the politics and the government most around them. That worries me a great deal. Forgive me for coming out, but I did want to follow up on Erica's remarks.
No problem. Erica.
I don't want to sharpen my last, my last answer. I think, and I've said this before, I don't know why it didn't come to me, but I would just say that, you know, the media relied on very traditional mechanisms for delivering journalism in a very non-traditional administration. And that's where I think we got a lot of the false equivalencies from for a while there. Can people be intimidated out of speaking the truth? I see it every day. And I will just say, I mean, think about all of the stories that you saw in the mainstream media that were the result of leaks from the Trump administration, that were from anonymous sources. I would say those are the people who spoke out through whistleblowing, because they were intimidated to speak the truth. In schools, I mean, teachers, it's rare that I get to quote a teacher speaking out about anything controversial. This is something that journalists see all the time, which is why we, you know, use anonymous sources, which became, you know, a dirty thing to do under the Trump administration, because, you know, that administration leaked like the Titanic. And so the only recourse they had was to try to discredit our reporting and discredit the use of anonymous sources, because that was really kind of the only way that the truth got out.
Any other comments on that? Can I move on to something that Ted Kennedy, good to hear from you, Ted. He says, politicians have a difficult job when their public would prefer to hear comfortable lies than uncomfortable truths. Could a scrupulously honest politician survive in our current societies? And Margaret Schuster says, should politicians listen to their voters or to their consciences? John Battle, do you want to have a go at that?
I think sometimes more was made of that. I never found, most of my arguments, and I would say this as a Roman Catholic, you might imagine there are some matters around particularly church teaching on sexual ethics, not least abortion, those kind of issues. And in the Labour Party, with strong women's movement and movement for women's rights, so you might imagine I'd come under massive, massive pressure. But I have to say, I found at that time that there was more respect for argument and reason and listening than there is now, is what I would say. My biggest arguments were actually around poverty within how we handle that within the system, and also around war, because despite my name, I was very much a peacenik. So what was really interesting was when it came to the conflicts, and I'm thinking the first war in a, you know, against Kuwait, I would find that the media in Britain, the Mail and the Daily Pops, would really whip up the people. And when I came home every weekend to my neighbourhood to meet with the people, they were all up for the war. I was the one arguing against it, and you're going to be thrown out because you're against the war. And people forget that at the time. You know, I just think that some of the issues around conscience and truth are not quite what people make out. And I think in the sense that you've got to be able to have the conversation with people and to challenge people. And I think where I wouldn't be able to do politics is simply getting a paying an agency to do opinion polling in my neighbourhood and ask them how they thought. Because if we'd had a bad murder in our neighbourhood, and we have one or two, then I'm pretty sure the death penalty would be on my list as the top issue next week. So you've got to challenge the issues. And I found that, I found fantastic respect from the people. The more that you could talk with the people. And that's why, I mean, my metaphor for politics, it may be different in the States, is if we have a system that's geographically based and you're elected, then you're in the neighborhood, and I live in my neighborhood and in parliament. And my metaphor would be from the woolen industry mills around me that are still around but shut down and turned into flats. But they have on them a shuttle that goes across the loom, and it's sharp at both edges. And you have to be sharp in the constituency and sharp in parliament, sometimes challenging the people at home, challenging the laws and budgets in parliament, and moving fast across that axis. And that's the metaphor I played. And I found the more honest I was, or more forthright I was, and I tend to be an outspoken Yorkshireman, the more I was straight talking with the people that I represented, the more support I got. Even though, John, we don't agree with you, but at least you tell us as it is. And so I found that you would still get the support if you actually entered into those conversations. My difficulty now is for politicians that, because of the murdering of politicians, they're driven into situations where they can't meet the people. They're going to be guarded. They can't do advice sessions in the way that we did. And they have a team of people walking around with them to make sure they're secure. So we're in a very dangerous moment for politics if politicians can't be literally available on the street in our society when we're geographically based on constituencies.
Just for our colleagues in the United States who might not know this, but a member of parliament was assassinated just a few weeks ago, a terrible situation. He was just holding his normal surgery, and he was stabbed to death. Meeting the people, making himself available to his constituents. Although the person concerned wasn't one of his constituents, had come in. Jenny, do you want to make any comments on that?
Yes, I'd like to emphasize that this is a really appropriate question. Because having just come to the end of COP26, basically what happened was that what everyone knows has to be done to deal with the climate problem has been watered down somewhat in order to be acceptable in a democratic system. And I think that a few months before the pandemic started, the great David Attenborough gave a talk in Parliament, and it was all about climate change, and he was taking questions and answers. And one of the things he said, we asked about China and climate change, or what he said was, when China gets the message, they will deal with it quickly and efficiently because they don't have to worry about democracy. and don't have to worry about the local issues connected with the change in the style of employment and so on. I think that is something that really is at the heart of our responses on climate change, because the problems go all the way down through society, local government, it goes all the way through regional and devolved governments and so on. But I agree with John. I don't think I ever went knocking on people's doors without someone talking to me about how dreadful immigration was. And that very frequently the conversation had a distinctly racist tone. And one of the things I promised myself when I became an elected member was that I would not agree with those people. Not out of courtesy, I wouldn't stand there and say they're there. I would enter into discussion with them. And I was very proud of the fact that I was able to hold myself to that standard, which was sometimes very difficult because, you know, you can be intimidated into not speaking out, and it also prolong your conversation, which might not be a very productive one. But in the end, people do acknowledge that you are prepared to go there, discuss the issues, argue the issues.
There was one occasion in my constituency when we were campaigning, and it was, I didn't inherit a safe seat, and I was told by the Labour Party I wouldn't win the seat, so I was just flying the flag, if you like. But I'd done a lot of work in one of our parts of the city with the black community, and because they were friends with me, they decided to put on a float, which was with a kettle drum band to give me a bit of whip up for a bit of party kazaz during the election campaign. I had a trade union minder because I was Labour, and they were a bit worried what I would say as a Yorkshireman. We'd gone out into West Leeds, which was more white working class, and in some areas the band was playing and women came down from the flats and were dancing. Then we went to one block of flats, and the van parked up, and this woman came out and screamed the most racist abuse at these youngsters on. And I got out of the car and I said to her, I want you to promise me you won't vote for me because I don't want your vote. And the trade union minders were going mad, saying, oh, I'd lose the election with one vote. It was terrible. Would I get back in the car? We forgot it. I did get elected. Weeks later, she my surgery and she apologized and she said, I'm really sorry, but I was so shocked at what you did. And I said, well, you don't need to apologize to me, you should apologize to those kids. I actually took her to the West Indian Center. I said, let's go for a decent night out. I took her to the West Indian Center, and before I'd gone to get a drink at the bar, she was in the middle of the room dancing and said it was the best night out of her life. And I just think it's, we've to challenge people and put them in positions where they meet human beings. And I think that's getting lost in the politics, where we turn it into a mezzanine floor, almost corporate management system, rather than a human conversation.
Thanks, John. We're going to have to tie it up soon, but there have been a couple of questions specifically to Erica, and maybe you can answer some of these. I'll go through them very quickly. Ms. Green, could you please speak to how traditional news outlets, such as the New York Times, compete with sensationalist news media? Is there a pressure to report sensationalist or partisan news? Has the NYT discussed this line in making their decisions? And another one, I wonder, Ms. Green, have you got any thoughts on the recent CNN report and racist, misogynist falsehoods being told by the media concerning Vice President Kamala Harris and other senior level colleagues on her staff? Lies such as they are not team players and they cause drama. Typical colonial rhetoric directed at women of color in power. Sorry to put those two questions to you, but would you like to?
I saw them, so I was getting ready. So one of them is going to be very easy. We do not compete with sensationalism news media. There is no pressure to, and I have not been a part of any discussion about taking, you know, this line to compete with media organizations that choose to frame their stories a certain way or take something from Twitter and run with it. Of course, you know, there's always the, do we need to follow this if it actually becomes a substantial issue? And I can just say my personal experience, I have never done that. And I'm going on 5 years. You know, we watch the news cycle and we watch a lot of different outlets, but you know, we pursue stories that meet our standards, that belong in, you know, the paper of record. And we never, you know, feel the need or any pressure, as far as I know, to compete because a story is, you know, going wild on Twitter or other social media, or because, you know, we're being accused of not following something for partisan reasons or what have you. You know, that's just kind of life at the New York Times. So no and no. And you know, I briefly read the story because I saw this question, the CNN story on Kamala Harris's office. And you know, I will just say, I always hesitate to comment on other reporters' stories, only because, you know, they are reporters. They spoke to people in the administration. They have sources. I'm not privy to those conversations. What I will say is, you know, this is not the first one of these stories about Kamala Harris's team. And I've seen the debates about whether or not it's being framed a certain way because she is a woman of color. I think it's, you know, given how women of color are treated and covered in the media, I am sensitive to the idea that people, you know, believe that she might be facing a different, you know, set of standards and under a cloud of scrutiny that someone in her position who was not a woman of color would be. But I just cannot, they reported that story. I actually know the lead writer. He's a man of color. And you know, I write stories all the time that get criticized. So you know, that's for, at the end of the day, they wrote the story for readers like you to decide whether or not, you know, based on who they quoted, what they found, what evidence they presented, for you to decide whether or not you're convinced, and for you to apply the lens that you have, and decide whether or not you think it's substantial or credible. So that's my non-answer, but.
Thank you very much.
I didn't finish the story either. I read the first few graphs, so I'm sorry. But you can email me and we can, once I finish it and dissect it, we can talk about it more if you'd like.
Thanks very much on that. Mm-hmm. We're gonna have to draw to a close, I'm afraid. Sandy, is there anything you want to say before we
close? Just quickly, Mike. I want to thank everybody for joining us. This was a wonderful conversation, and thank Georgetown University in particular for its ongoing support of these monthly programs, helping us keep our projects above water and through the pandemic. I do want to note that just last week, the Free Speech Tracker, which is the sort of flagship service of the Free Speech Project at Georgetown, hit a milestone of posting its 500th entry about free speech challenges in the United States in social media, in civil society, in government, and in higher education. And the website address is freespeechproject, all one word, .georgetown.edu. And we welcome anyone else joining us who would be so inclined. A pleasure to be with you again today. Back to you, Mike.
Well, thanks very much. And it is a terrific project going on there in Georgetown. And we're very, very pleased to be linked with it, with the Future of the Humanities. May I thank John Battle, Jenny Randerson, Erica Green, Steve Hess. I think it's been a fantastic debate this afternoon. And also my colleague, Sandy Ungar, for today's discussion. Thanks to the people at Georgetown, Jack DeJoy, the president, Tom Banshoff, vice president. At Blackfriars, thanks to John O'Connor, the regent, Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute. And at Campion Hall, my thanks to Nick Austin, the master of the hall, and Sarah Gray and Ying Ying, Campion Hall administrators. Also thanks to John McCabe and colleagues at Georgetown who made this Zoom event happen. And thanks to all of you who've asked questions, and indeed all of you who have been tuned in. If we haven't answered any of the questions, we will endeavour to email answers to you. The next free speech project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event in association with the Future of the Humanities Project will be on Monday, the 13th of December at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. BST, when we will be discussing issues related, would you believe, to climate change and to what we've thought of COP, I'm sure, and what has come out of COP. There are two further events I'd like to draw your attention to. Tomorrow, the 16th of November, 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. GMT, there will be a talk on the Christian Literary Imagination series when John Ford Rescher from Georgetown will be speaking on Imagining Christianity, Robert Browning's Christmas Eve and Easter Day, which is all about truth, actually, so and interpretations of truth. So I do recommend that to you. And he'll be in conversation with my convener for that series, Joseph Simmons SJ, who's a research fellow at Campion Hall, Oxford. And then there will be another Zoom in our China series on Friday, the 3rd of December, when Alexa Jobin from George Washington University, Washington, DC, will be discussing Asian embodiment of a white canon, Shakespeare and the Sinophone world. That's going to be a fantastic talk, I think, from a colleague just at George Washington down the road from Georgetown. Please note the time is changed for this talk, because it will take place at 1:30 p.m. EST in the US, and 6:30 p.m. in the UK. And that's because Alexa is teaching all that morning, all right? So we had to push it on, so it'll be a bit later. So please join us for those events. Thank you for all you all for attending today. Thank you again to the panel. I've really enjoyed listening to every word. And I hope we'll see you again at some point in further discussions. I'm Professor Mike Scott, Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Until next time, take care, keep safe, goodbye, and again, my thanks.